BD Physicians established in April 2020. Our view is to share and distribute knowledge, develop skill of the physicians of our country and internationally. During this pandemic time, we have organized more than 50 scientific sessions. Our today's speakers are Professor Debashish Chandra from India and Professor Syed Atiqul Haq from BSMMU, Bangladesh. Two leading rheumatologists of Asia-Pacific region and as well as globally. They are president of Rheumatology Society of their country as well as holding top post of APLAR, which is Asia-Pacific League of Associations for Rheumatology. And with us, we have two distinguished panelists, Professor Ismail Patwari, is principal Sylhet Women's Medical College and ex-department head of medicine, Sylhet M.H. Osman Medical College. And with us also, Professor Pradeep Kumar Dutta, he's professor of nephrology, ex-vice principal of Chittagong Medical College and department head of nephrology, Chittagong Medical College. And with us, our today's chairperson is Professor M.A. Jalil Chaudhary. Professor M.A. Jalil Chaudhary was ex-chairman of Department of Medicine, Bangabandhu Sheikh Mujib Medical University, and he was ex-honorary secretary of Bangladesh College of Physicians and Surgeons. And Professor Jalil Chaudhary, sir, also hold post of Bangladesh, also hold a post of president of Bangladesh Rheumatology. Okay.
So, as Professor Jalil has said and Dr. Atiqul has said, it is such a common disease which is actually missed out in routine evaluation by physicians and rheumatologists. I will just take you through the journey of Sjögren's syndrome from mere disbelief to the data-driven reality. I'll just tell, this is about CMC Vellore. This is the lady who came from Boston 120 years back to Vellore to establish a bullock cart roadside clinic and a two-bedded maternity hospital, which is today the hospital, CMC Vellore, which is about 130 kilometers from Chennai, down south in India. So what are the common perceptions about Sjögren's syndrome? So there are a lot of common myths which exist. The first of all, it's as Atik has mentioned very correctly. So this is, many people call it Sjögren's syndrome. It's not Sjögren. It's correct pronunciation is Sjögren. It's in German. And Sjögren's thesis was in Stockholm. But before the Second World War, their official language was German. And in German, SJ is pronounced like SH in English. So it is pronounced like a Sjögren syndrome. So the most common myth is it is a dry eye, dry mouth disease. So Atik has made my job so easy. If you ask the patient direct questioning, you will find that the patient with a significant dry eye, dry mouth also will deny the history. The most important aspect of this disease is it is not just a disease of dryness. It is a multi-system autoimmune disease affecting many systems. As Atik has mentioned, it can cause renal tubular acidosis, it can cause vasculitis, it can cause lymphoma, it can cause tubular interstitial nephritis. The second myth is Sikka symptoms are the presenting complaint in all patients, which I have already mentioned. Actually, I'll show you our data, and now it is globally accepted that the majority of the patients actually do not volunteer to the doctors complaining of Sikka symptoms. They come with the other manifestations, and that is such a wide and protean manifestation that the Sikka symptoms is rarely either presenting a symptom by volunteering by the patient. On asking, it is there, but they never volunteer. It was a myth in our country earlier, and I'm sure this will be the same in the whole of the subcontinent, that it is rare. In fact, I was a co-author in a paper 25 years back that Sjögren's syndrome is rare in India. which I have revised now myself. And primary Sjogren syndrome is a grossly missed diagnosis because it is not often a very aggressive disease. So this is the image of Sjogren syndrome in our mind. So if you see a picture like this, and if you see such a prominent parotid, and you can see the tongue is so dry, it's probably very easy to diagnose Sjogren syndrome. But the knowledge bias in Sjogren syndrome, even amongst the rheumatologists, is because of the most published and cited literature on Sjogren syndrome is based on the Western literature, largely derived from the Caucasian population, and the overall understanding of primary Sjogren's in one's mind is that of this picture, with such prominent salivary parotid glands, and you can see the dry tongue. Is this the prototype in our population, whether it is India or the subcontinent? So you will know that the one of the few things that has happened in the last 10 to 15 years is that we don't no more wait for Schwann neck or Boutonnière deformity in hands to call rheumatoid arthritis. We don't wait for bamboo spine to call someone with ankylosing spondylitis. Similarly, we don't wait for parotid enlargement, dry eye and dry mouth to be so significant to call it Sjogren syndrome. In fact, by the time the parotid enlargement happens, the Sjogren's patient might actually have lymphoma. So here is another story. Atik has given already beautiful stories. This is one story of a 49-year-old female with 5-year history of recurrent attacks of severe proximal muscle weakness in presence of normal muscle enzymes and normal vitamin D levels, almost same like what Atik had presented. And patient comes to internal medicine and neurology. And so you can now very easily know when you come eventually what it is. She has low potassium and low pH in arterial blood gas. So it is like that similar presentation comes to internal medicine and endocrinologist. And then she's edentulous from the age of 35. So this is a very important, as Professor Jalil has said, that dry mouth has so many causes. Absolutely true. But if you find someone at the age of 35 losing all the teeth, then you must think. And the patient may go to dental, and probably dentists most of the time will not, they will ignore to find out what is the reason for the premature loss of teeth. She also has pain and intermittent swelling of small joints of hands with some contractures in the proximal interphalangeal joints, and the pain responds to NSAIDs, thereby supporting the diagnosis of an inflammatory arthropathy. And she has features of asymmetric peripheral neuropathy. Atik has shown cases with significant peripheral neuropathy. And when it is asymmetric, you know, it might be a features like a vasculitic or a small fiber neuropathy. So patient came to rheumatologist and neurologist again for consultation. And then she also had one late fetal death and one early neonatal death. Cause is unknown to the obstetrician and the patient. And only other obstetrical and gynecological history is that of dyspareunia, which was again emphasized by Dr. Jalil and Dr. Atik, that often the women will not come forward with this history to male doctors. So she has gone to obstetrics and gynecology, and you can imagine this is possibly because of the SSA and the SSB antibody causing complete heart block. Now the patient goes to the dermatologist with this kind of rashes, and you know it is very well, it is a palpable purpura, small vessel vasculitis. She also denies any history of dry eye or dry mouth. And there was no ophthalmic consult was done by any of the doctors. Imagine the patient visited 5 or 6 specialties already, but nobody had referred to ophthalmology because on direct questioning, she denied. But because we have the specialty bias, we had asked the patient about carrying water in winter everywhere or difficulty in swallowing dry food, and does she put eye drops? And she came out with the history that she carries water with her everywhere, even in winter, cannot eat biscuits without getting stuck in her tongue and throat, and regularly put eye drops for more than 10 years. So imagine how contradictory is the history on the lady who is putting eye drops has forgotten she has dry eye, and the lady who cannot swallow biscuits without having extra water, even in winter she has to carry water, but she denies history of dry eye. So such is the history. Now, what is the common impression of the salivary gland enlargement in Sjogren's syndrome? If you see, if you have an early patient, you may or may not find it. And imagine this kind of minimum parotid enlargement may be easily overlooked by any physician or rheumatologist, even the surgeons, because people may pass it off. This is normal. People might have had mumps in childhood and may have it. So therefore, it is not very easy to find classical parotid enlargement. Similarly, only a very high degree of suspicion can find out lacrimal gland enlargement in patients with Sjogren's syndrome. It may be easily overlooked. And this is a simple test every rheumatology trainee or even physician trainee should carry the ready-made, commercially available Wattman number 3 filter paper is available with the angulation made here, which can be with clean hand, place it under the conjunctiva, wait for 5 minutes and see the wetting here. It was less than 5 millimeter in 5 minutes, it shows dry eye. It's only about 40% sensitive. It is not most sensitive. And the lip biopsy is very simple procedure. And lip biopsy can be easily done by any physician trainee or rheumatology trainee. And the local anesthesia, the moment you put an incision horizontally, you get the glands popping out and you can easily get 10 to 16 glands. But you need minimum 4 evaluable glands and pour it in formalin. It should not float. If it floats, it may be a fatty tissue. If it sinks, it is a salivary gland tissue. Cover it nicely with a sellotape. Otherwise, often the small ampules may open up and the gland may be in the floor. You will never find it. So this is how the Sjogren syndrome comes. Arthik has described Daniel scoring from 0 to grade 4. And grade 3 onwards is called focus score 1 and above. So once it is a focus score 1 and above, it is significant inflammation suggestive of Sjogren's. Now you can see the process of the plight of a patient with Sjogren's syndrome, how it goes from doctor to doctor and how delay happens in diagnosis. I just want to recognize this was my senior during my immunology training, and he's now a hematologist, and he's the one who actually stimulated me to think about Sjogren's syndrome in those rheumatoid patients who never deformed or the deformity is correctable. And this is Dr. Vanchu. This is Dr. Sunil Davadgaon. Dr. Vanchu is in the US now, in Portland, in the West Coast, near West Coast of USA. He is the one who taught me salivary gland biopsy in OPDs, and I have done at least 1,000 lip biopsies myself. Now I don't do anymore. The students do. This is Dr. Maureen Richmuller in Adelaide, with whom I have worked. I was 3 years in Adelaide in Australia, and I spent 1.5 years with her. And it was really influence of her, which made me pick up Sjogren's from fibromyalgia, from CIDP, from irritable bladder syndrome, all kinds of conditions which would be otherwise people will not suspect of Sjogren's. So how do you suspect Sjogren in rheumatology clinic? Any chronic inflammatory non-deforming of Jakut type of arthropathy. We are taught in internal medicine that Jakut arthropathy happens in rheumatic fever. Rheumatic fever has become almost not visible nowadays. It's quite rare because of widespread use of antibiotic. But Jakut deformity or a correctable deformity is because of periarticular tissue involvement and non-erosive arthritis is seen in Sjogren's syndrome, probably much more common than rheumatic fever. Chronic pain features fibromyalgia, chronic fatigue syndrome, and the spectrum of chronic pain disorders are the ones where you should spend time looking for history of dry eye and dry mouth by indirect questioning and examining. Premature loss of teeth, as I mentioned to you, very poor oral and dental and gingival hygiene in a person who otherwise has a good socioeconomic background, and you have indirect queries about oral and ocular sicca symptoms, also dry skin and dyspareunia. Hypokalemic periodic paralysis is very important. In our series of more than 400 patients, we had about 30 patients we had with hypokalemic periodic paralysis, and all of them were missed out by many specialties, except one or two were diagnosed by endocrinologists. Chronic idiopathic demyelinating polyneuropathy, CIDP, is like a GV syndrome type disease. It's a very important condition. If it is a chronic, you must think of Sjogren's. Small vessel and medium vessel vasculitis, where there are some of these clues as above. So this is about our hospital. This is the old building. This is some of the, our maternity and children's building. This is the college chapel. And we see about 12,000 patients every day in outpatient and 2,500 inpatients in Vellore. Rheumatology alone sees more than 60,000 patients here, which is actually much more. This is about more than 2 years back. And we have large cohort of autoimmune rheumatic diseases with us. This is my teacher in Lucknow, Dr. Mishra. And this is Professor Hal Schofield, one of the top experts in Sjogren's syndrome in Oklahoma Medical Research Foundation in the USA. I had spent 1 year with him. And these are the people who had also influenced me significantly in working towards Sjogren's syndrome. So imagine, I'll start the story how. This is in 2003, when in a series from Lucknow, Dr. Mishra and other group had published that the Sjogren's syndrome, they only had 26 patients over so many years of follow-up. And they have reported the Sjogren's is extremely rare. The same story was from Southern India in Chennai. They also had 36 patients over, imagine, a 5 year history. Again, they have reported it's much rarer than Western population. So was Sjogren really rare in our country? So Indian Rheumatology Conference in 2005 in Hyderabad, I had presented 126 patients of primary Sjogren syndrome over period of 10 years. Amma. And imagine the
Astama mama ma beta baba ma mama iragadin
so the critics in the meeting had raised eyebrows. Are these really primary or they are secondary Sjogren's? Indian rheumatoid arthritis may have secondary Sjogren's early, so I may be mistaking rheumatoid as Sjogren's syndrome. And many such expert comments came. So this was the time of disbelief and how to go about the reality. So we know it is a heterogeneous disease. It has got not only disabling sicca symptoms, but a lot of extra glandular features, and it's got considerable immunological and clinical research to a significant advances that are made in diagnosis and prognosis and management. Because it's a low grade disease, it has a varied and protean manifestation. There are more than 12 criteria till date. Some are too sensitive, some are too specific. But it is still a most underdiagnosed condition, and most estimates say that the Sjogren's prevalence in population anywhere between 0.5 to 2% of population, and it is almost at the same prevalence as rheumatoid arthritis, if not more. So these are some of the studies on the prevalence of Sjogren's syndrome by community-based data. So you can see the variation in prevalence in different populations at different times. So because of the inconsistent criteria and poor awareness, inconsistence and poor awareness in the past, we had difficulty in diagnosing. There are also ethnic and geographic variations. We learned to recognize Sjogren's as a systemic disease rather than dry eye and dry mouth disease, and direct questioning for these two symptoms will only miss out in vast majority, as Professor Atik. Currently, the modest estimate says is 0.5% is the lowest incidence we can get using the strictest criteria. So primary Sjogren's syndrome, there is also differences between East and the West. And if you see, this is a Chinese series, and they have shown that our patients present much younger than the Western patients. In Western countries, Sjogren's is considered to be a postmenopausal disease, whereas in our patient, mostly 30s, 40s are the ones who come with Sjogren's syndrome. Sicca symptoms are less common, even after asking, than Western country. the fatigue is less common. Probably that's why they are not so much bothered. Raynaud's phenomenon is less common. The pulmonary involvement is almost similar. The renal involvement is little more. And the SSA and SSB positivity, or Rho and La positivity, is much higher than the Western population. So there was no community or hospital-based data. The hospital-based data from different regions of India, the Indian Rheumatology Association started in 2012, and I was asked to make the data of our hospital. It was presented in December 2012. The objective was to do in this retrospective study to characterize clinical presentation, immunological profile, and outcome in a cohort of Indian patients of Sjogren's syndrome. And the electronic medical records are studied with suspected Sjogren's syndrome between 2004 and 11 in our hospital, and outpatient inpatient records are retrieved. Patients are screened for primary Sjogren's syndrome if they fulfill 4 out of the 6 criteria by American European Consensus Group Classification, or AECG. At that time, that was the only one was looked at. So this is the AECG criteria. Out of these 6 criteria, from 3, 4, 5, 6 are objective. However, criteria 5, we never did. We didn't do anybody salivary flow estimate, abnormal sialography, or scintigraphy, being invasive procedures involving radioactive isotopes here. So we have done all the other features which is needed. So imagine when you ask for ocular symptoms, you must ask for foreign, as Atikas said, foreign body sensation in the eye, or use of artificial tears more than 3 per day. And similarly for dry mouth, recurrent or persistent swollen salivary glands, or need liquid to swallow dry foods. And Sharma's test, as I told you, it's about 40% sensitive. And we have positive vital dye stainings, different types of there. Now there is ocular staining score and histopathology focus score of more than 1. And autoantibody antibody Rho and La, earlier there was also inclusion of ANA and rheumatoid factor. Now, this is the picture which shown a few minutes back. So the diagnosis of primary Sjogren's, if you have 4 out of the 6 or 3 out of the 4 objective criteria between 3 and 6. However, if the presence of any one symptom, 1 or 2, plus 2 out of 3 objective criteria, 3, 4, 5, and 6, then we can always diagnose Sjogren's syndrome. But if there is a well-defined primary connective tissue disease associated, we call it secondary Sjogren's syndrome. And these are the exclusion criteria at that time. As Atikas mentioned very clearly, hepatitis C, HIV, radiation, lymphoma, sarcoidosis, graft-versus-host disease. And it was that time current use of anticholinergic drugs. Now it is replaced by IgG4 disease, which Atikas mentioned. The 2002 AECG criteria had these 6 criteria, and the rules for classification, absence of exclusion criteria, which I have mentioned, presence of any 4 of the 6 with at least item 4 or 6, or presence of any 3 of the 4 objective items. So this is what has been mentioned. But can Sjogren's be diagnosed in absence of Sitka symptoms? Can some strongly suspected patients may not be fulfilling the criteria? Still, we can diagnose Sjogren's or not, and also the relevance of Sitka symptoms. So the strong suspects who did not fulfill AECG criteria, we went for the Sitka criteria, which is 2 out of 3. I'll come to what is Sitka criteria, which is now become eventually with some refinement into ACR criteria. And those with another connective tissue disease or an overlap with another disease, like Sjogren's, is often overlaps with MCTD. So those are excluded. And clinical and presentations, extraglandular feature, disease duration, immune profile are retrospectively documented. So this is the original Sitka criteria. You need to have either SSA, SSB, or positive rheumatoid factor, or ANA titer more than 1:320. And salivary gland having a 1 focus per 4 mm² area, and objective keratoconjunctivitis Sitka by ocular staining score, which is a very stringent scoring system, which only the ophthalmologist can do. Separate staining by lissamine green and fluorescent dye for cornea and conjunctiva. So exclusions here are similar like what I have mentioned the earlier ACG criteria, except the anticholinergic drugs have been removed by IgG4 related disease. So the results, what we found, so we had 423 patients who were subjected to ACG criteria, 129 were negative and 294 are positive. And we also, those who were negative, they were subjected to Sitka criteria. We had another 38 patients who were negative by ACG but positive by Sitka criteria, and that made it 332 number of patients of Sjogren syndrome, talking of quite almost 8 years back. And the baseline demography, interestingly, the female predominance is almost 20:1, 18.5:1, much more than lupus and other autoimmune rheumatic diseases. And the age group is 45 plus minus 10 years. So it is still much younger than the Western population, which is almost by rule postmenopausal. And the mean duration is about 5 years before we diagnose these patients. And the presenting feature, so here I would like your attention to be paid. So you just see, being a rheumatology clinic, of course, we have almost 60% patients having arthritis or arthralgia. And we also had about 6% with chronic pain syndrome. And you had patients with hypokalemic periodic paralysis, glandular swelling, paresthesia, skin rash, and others as the presenting features by patient themselves. But what I am trying to say, draw your attention here is, see, only 8% of patients actually volunteered at the first visit of Sitka symptoms. They came to any doctor in the hospital complaining of dry eye and dry mouth. Only 8%, 92% did not. So this is another feature of the fibromyalgia trigger points. And we should not forget, as fibromyalgia patients, often we try to throw them into waste basket as, you know, some kind of junk in our clinic. But many patients of Sjogren's, you may pick up from fibromyalgia. The clinical features, however, I have mentioned just now to you how they're presented first. But how about during follow-up, how their disease behaved? So when you looked at eventually with objective evaluation follow-up, we had almost 90% had dry eye, 94% dry mouth, about 90% had Schirmer's test positive, and 94% had lip biopsy positive, 64% had SSA or raw antibody positive, and 38% of almost 40% had raw antibody or SSB positive, and we had 62/3 of patients had ANA positivity, and about 60% had rheumatoid factor positivity. Now, we found out of these 332 patients, there were 1/3 of patients who had major systemic features, and about 2/3 had other features. So if you see the arthralgia, arthritis, chronic pain, dental problem, parotid anomaly, skin rashes, bladder dyspareunia, GI, respiratory, renal, RTA, depression, neurological, myopathy, vasculitic, hematological, and END, in that order. So this is the same thing what I have shown just now in graphical presentation. So among the skin manifestations, the commonest was palpable purpura like this, and other non-specific erythematous rash, urticaria, erythema nodosum, Raynaud's, atrophy blanche, and gangrene. The respiratory, about 40 patients, and about half of them had interstitial lung disease. About 10 of them had obstructive airway disease, bronchiectasis, pleural effusion, alveolar hemorrhage, pulmonary thromboembolism, and pulmonary nodule in few patients. The neurological, again, mononeuritis multiplex, presenting as foot drop or wrist drop, reflective of vasculitis, medium vessel vasculitis, and symmetric polyneuropathy, followed by one patient each of trigeminal neuropathy, seizure, aseptic meningitis, CIDP, and dyspareunia, dysautonomia. The gastrointestinal manifestation, out of the 27 patients, majority had IBS. So remember, the IBS, irritable bowel syndrome, chronic pain or fibromyalgia, migraine, premenstrual tension, they all form the spectrum of what is known as repetitive strain injury or central sensitization disorder. And irritable bowel syndrome and the whole of the central sensitization disorder spectrum, patients should be investigated for Sjogren's syndrome, because Sjogren's patients have significantly higher altered substance P serotonin axis. The autoimmune hepatitis, primary biliary cirrhosis, celiac disease, ileocolitis, autoimmune cholangitis, and atrophic gastritis in one patient each. The hematological manifestation, we had thrombocytopenia in 14, leukopenia in 18. Lymphoma, we had in 3 patients, pseudolymphoma in 2 of them, monoclonal gammopathy of uncertain significance in 4, Kikuchi's lymphadenitis in 1, and nonspecific hepatosplenomegaly in 3. And renal involvement, we had 14 patients with proteinuria who refused to undergo kidney biopsy, but those who had undergone kidney biopsy, we had 7 of them with glomerulonephritis, not so common, mostly mesangial. And we had chronic interstitial nephritis, as Atik has mentioned, renal stones, medullary nephrocalcinosis in 2 patients, chronic kidney disease, and medullary cystic kidney disease in 1 each. Bad obstetrical outcome was in 20 patients, spontaneous abortion in 14 patients, complete heart block in 2, and infertility in 5. And out of this spontaneous abortion, surprisingly, only patients with antiphospholipid syndrome was very rare. The 8 patients had SSA and SSB, 3 had SSA alone, 2 had antiphospholipid antibody alone, and only 1 patient where SSA, SSB was not done. So now we have some methods by statistics where we call it a cluster analysis. When you did a cluster analysis, what we found is that the people with the milder symptoms had actually clustered together, like arthritis, chronic pain, etc. And the serious symptom like vasculitic, neurological manifestations, high titer antibody positivity had all formed another cluster. So we know that there are 2 different categories of patients. So we did a multivariate logistic regression to find out whether any predictors of systemic involvement. I mentioned to you 1/3 of them had systemic involvement and 2/3 had only non-systemic or general manifestations. And what we found is if a person had anti-Rho and anti-La antibody, the 3 or 2 times higher, 2.5 times to 3 times, 3.5 times higher chance of having systemic involvement. Whereas if it is a chronic pain syndrome like fibromyalgia, this is chronic pain, not carpal tunnel syndrome. Patients have a lesser chance of having systemic involvement. So a Sjogren's with fibromyalgia and chronic pain features, irritable bowel syndrome, are likely to be milder disease without much serious organ involvement, a less chance of antibody positivity. So the likelihood ratio also, we worked out and found that SSA and SSB or Rho and La antibody titer, if it is more than 160 units per ml, it was more like 2 to 3 times higher chance in patients with skin, renal, neurological, and vasculitis or the major systemic features. So major systemic features on Sjogren's syndrome are more likely to be associated with antibody, high titer antibody positivity. Now about malignancy, we only had this few patients and we had acute leukemia in 1, suspected hepatocellular carcinoma, long-standing autoimmune process in the liver, autoimmune hepatitis. It was not confirmed. Suspected lymphoma in 1, parotid lymphoma 1, and B-cell lymphoma 1. So it was not as common as in the Western population. And we looked at all the patients who were suspected for Sjogren's, but some of them who did not even fulfill the criteria. We looked at them also, whether they had any lymphoma. So when we compared our data with other series, so this is, you can see that our patients had basically much younger patients. So you can see 44 versus 53, 62, 53 here. And if you see the other manifestations, which are different from other, you can see that the antibody positivity is much higher in our patients compared to all the other series, Rho and La. And we had no patient with cryoglobulinemia at that time. And we had very low patients with hyperglobulinemia. And we also had very less Raynaud's phenomenon in our patients, only 1 patient compared to others. And this is the same thing has been shown here, just to highlight the differences between our series versus the large series from others. Others are multicentric series. Ours is a single center single center largest number. So this was published in 2015. And after this publication, we got an invitation from the International Sjogren's Big Data Group. And they had invited us to join. So now we are part of this big data group. And we have contributed our patient cohort to them. It is a cohort of in totally about 50 nations, 31, 10,000 patients plus, and in that patient, our patients comprised. So again, the first of this series, the series of publications came from the big data group. And what we found is the female ratio is more in Asians, and the prevalence of Sikka is lowest in Asians. So this is because of ours in the Chinese series. Then we also published the determinants of diagnosis and delay and the course in primary Sjogren syndrome. How about the result from data mining of electronic health records? I have mentioned to you that the patient go from doctor to doctor. What is the, we looked at this, why it is happening. So we did. So this is the list of specialties of 275 patients who first visited this, whose first specialty of consultation included all. And one, I must tell you that majority came to rheumatology, but the next largest cohort came to general medicine. So it's very important that the general medicine also keeps an open eye and high degree of suspicion to suspect. All the others came in small numbers in different specialties. And this is the distribution of the 275 patients of their first consultation symptoms and complaint. Again, musculoskeletal, neurological, Sikka, skin problems, and autoimmune disease diagnosed elsewhere. Just non-specific systemic autoimmune disease. Sometimes you get referrals like that, ANA positive, they call it connective tissue disease without a label. They did not fulfill the criteria for lupus and others. So these are the ways people can go to different specialties, from dental to endocrine to gastrointestinal, glandular, hematological, obstetrical, pregnancy-related, psychiatric, and all kinds of manifestations. And this is something like a heat map you do for the, or the gene array studies or the protein array studies. So we looked at all the specialties where the diagnosis of these 275 patients are made as Sjogren's, connective tissue diseases, rheumatoid arthritis, lupus, like that, how they were diagnosed in different specialties. On the bottom is the total number, and this column shows who are. So rheumatology diagnosed 83 of them out of 275. Internal medicine is the next 19 patients they diagnosed. Also 6 by ophthalmologist, and rest are very few they diagnosed as Sjogren syndrome. And you can see the presentations and the odds ratios which make us help diagnosis of Sjogren syndrome. So if you see that the various features, if you see what makes higher odds ratio is the Sikka. If it's obvious Sikka, it is helpful. If the patient has visited a rheumatology with a suspected Sjogren syndrome, if the first impression has been primary Sjogren syndrome, if you have asked about Sikka, if you have ordered an SSA antibody with high degree of suspicion, these are the ones which make the diagnosis of the probability of the odds ratio much higher than 2. You can see that, and make us help us diagnose Sjogren syndrome. So this is what is we have seen. And Sikka symptoms were spontaneously complained only in 12%, even in this analysis. So you can see out of 275 in this series from different specialties, again, our original series had 332 had 8%, this is 12%. And the provisional diagnosis of primary Sjogren's was made in about half the patients comprising of all the specialties they visited, as I mentioned to you. So the 24 different specialties have been visited by 275 patients of definitive Sjogren syndrome, and two-thirds were diagnosed by the rheumatologist. How about the ophthalmologist, who had a biased referral because the highly suspected Sikka symptoms? They had very high specificity, but small number, 6 out of 8. And the parotid gland enlargement surgeons who did a biopsy, again, high specificity, because again, referral bias, because of very prominent symptom. Now patients who do not volunteer for Zika symptoms, I have mentioned that this is how we can diagnose. Now, paucity of Zika symptoms in India, maybe whole of subcontinent, is why is it so? So this is one of the studies we found the Zika is less common in our population. The big data, as I mentioned to you, have also shown that we have much less, even after objective evaluation, our Zika presentation is lower than the Western population. And the objective dryness is in India recently found, even though it is not complained, it is present in about 90%. And telltale features include then dental caries in 60%. And 40% patient never complained of Zika symptom. So why less Zika symptoms? It's probably the perception of the illness. Patient may not be much disturbed about the Zika in the face of other major symptoms. Our life is much more difficult maybe than the Westerners. There's no temporal relationship often with Zika in our population. The Caucasian population age at onset is perimenopausal. Ours is much younger in onset. The wordings of question, if you ask direct questioning, as I have mentioned, Professor Atikul also has mentioned, the dry eye, dry mouth, if you ask, you may not get. And extra glandular features can precede the occurrence of Zika. The association of Zika symptoms, the Zika cohort had showed the dry eye, dry mouth symptom did not show a significant association with presence of lymphocytic infiltration, serum, anti-SSB ocular signs. In fact, many think whether it is because of the autonomic nervous system involvement in the glands, salivary and the lacrimal glands. So this is another study which tried to correlate the immunological profile with various clinical manifestations. What we can see is the articular hardly has significant immunological association. And they've taken a very high p-value to define that. Whereas major systemic manifestation correlate with the autoantibodies, low complements, etc. So what it means is, as we have mentioned in our series, that the immunological abnormalities and major systemic manifestations seem to correlate very well. And whereas minor manifestations are non-systemic, like articular and other muscular manifestations, do not correlate very well with immunological profile or autoantibodies. The systemic manifestations of primary Sjogren's syndrome, the out of the ESSDI classification, and they looked at the prevalence and the clinical relevance in large cohort, which I am part of it. And they have also found that more than a quarter of patients with primary Sjogren's syndrome, like we have mentioned in our series, one-third patients may have major systemic manifestations. And those features, one-fourth of them may not be even included in the ESSDI classification. So therefore, these are not thought of. So this is the picture how from 10% constitutional features, 2% CNS features, 22% glandular features, 10% lymph node enlargements, 5% renal, 38% articular, cutaneous 10%, peripheral neuropathy 6%, muscular 2%, pulmonary 11%, such a wide varied manifestation. And so the ESSDI classification shows here that the articular features seems to be still very predominant features, but again, cutaneous, CNS, peripheral nervous system, the glandular features, constitutional pulmonary Raynaud's, as I mentioned, are important manifestations of Sjogren's syndrome. So they can be easily missed out if they may be going with one or other symptom to different specialties. And this is the same thing when they have shown that if you go with the ESSDI criteria, you can see that the Rho antibody and the La antibodies is present between 80 and 60% of patients, whereas ESSDI criteria may pick up only about 20% of patients. Now, this is an important table. I would like all the internists and even maybe the trainees in rheumatology to look at. So these are some of the manifestations in various neurological, hematological, pulmonological, nephrology, obstetrics, ENT, pediatrics, dermatology, urology, cardiovascular, and different kind of manifestations which which may present as a clue towards Sjogren's syndrome. So the most important is the vasculitic features like mononeuritis multiplex, trigeminal neuralgia, along with other suspecting features, multiple sclerosis like features, Graves' disease, transverse myelitis, aseptic meningitis, when you have the other clues. The autoimmune cytopenias, Evans syndrome, or MGUS, or lymphomas. You have interstitial lymphoma, you have LIP or lymphocytic interstitial pneumonia, and you have interstitial nephritis, periodic paralysis, osteomalacia, as Professor Atikul has shown beautiful slides of pseudofractures, renal tubular acidosis. You can have complete heart block in the fetus, very important clue mother may have, and it may not be diagnosed for decades. Neonatal lupus to a mother, must immediately evaluate the mother. Recurrent parotid enlargement, parotid masses, sensory neural hearing loss. We published a series of hearing loss in Sjogren as a presenting feature. ENT lymphomas. Parotid enlargement is usually a late feature, very rarely PUO, and generalized lymphadenopathy. You can also have, apart from vasculitis, the other features. Article mentioned about the arterial hypercomplementemic vasculitis or C1q antibody mediated vasculitis, urolithiasis because of medullary disease, the interstitial nephritis, and we have also Raynaud's phenomenon, sometimes one of the manifestations also. So this is like when each specialty looks at the patient like a 10 blind person trying to examine an elephant. So if someone is feeling the drum, he'll say the elephant is like a big snake. If someone is just feeling the feet, he said, no, it is actually a tree stump. Or someone who is just feeling the ear, he said, what you are saying, it is like a sheath of leather. Or someone who is examining the tail, he says, you are all wrong. It's actually like a little furry mouse. So it is not just a disease of dryness. It's a complex heterogeneous disease. It presents with systemic autoimmune manifestations characterized by B-cell activation, lymphocytic infiltration of the exocrine glands with or without dryness, and anti-Rho positivity. And therefore, 2016, as Professor Atikul has mentioned, that the ACR-EULAR criteria has now made it even more objective with weighting, with weightage scores. If you have a focus score of 1 and above, you get a score of 3. If you get a Rho positive score of 3, if you have ocular staining score of more than 5, in at least one eye, you get score of 1. Sharma's less than 5 millimeter in 5 minutes, get a score of 1. Unstimulated whole salivary flow rate of less than 0.1 ml per minute, get a score of 1. So you can, whereas ESSDAI has 12 domains, and I have shown you that those domains can actually miss out many of the features. So with this weighted score, we can diagnose. So you can see now, compared to some years back, if at least one symptom of dry eye or dry mouth present, and if you objectively find features of dry eye by ocular staining score or Sharma's test, or you have objective dry mouth by salivary flow reduction, subject to antibody, if you have either SSA antibody positivity or a biopsy showing a focus score of 1, it becomes Sjogren's. Or you have suspected Sjogren's with at least one ESSDAI domain positives, but there is no Sikka symptom. ESSDAI has got a whole lot of symptomatology I have mentioned to you, and you've got many systemic features, but there is no objective ocular or oral event. So there's no dry eye, there's no dry mouth. Some of the systemic features which Sjogren's can manifest with involving the renal or neurological, etc. And if you have antibody positivity and biopsy positivity, it becomes Sjogren's syndrome. So either antibody or biopsy positivity, which you can do in OPD with local anesthesia, very simple. And if you have objective dry eye or dry mouth, it is Sjogren. Or you have systemic features of Sjogren without any dry eye or dry mouth, and you have both antibody and muscle and the salivary gland muscle minus salivary gland biopsy positivity, it becomes Sjogren's syndrome. So antibody and biopsy are most important, and you can have Sjogren's syndrome without dry eye and dry mouth. So that is the crux of the thing today. So to diagnose primary Sjogren's syndrome early, remember, patients do not volunteer Sikka symptom. Negative response, even on enquiry, may be there. Telltale features like caries, long-standing non-deforming arthritis are important clues. A primary Sjogren's syndrome often are misdiagnosed as rheumatoid arthritis or lupus. Sicca features are not obvious or inquired about often. And all ANA positive patients are not lupus. All rheumatoid factor positive patients are not rheumatoid arthritis. Is this positivities can be there in Sjogren's syndrome, as Professor Atikul Haq has mentioned. In fact, Sjogren's may have a higher chance of having rheumatoid factor positivity than Sjogren's syndrome. And we apply the exclusion criteria, rule out hepatitis C, HIV, sarcoidosis, and IgG4 related. This is very important, like Nicolaides syndrome, and predominant systemic features which are related to Sjogren's syndrome. So, and the one of the last slides, the Sjogren's in India and maybe the subcontinent has a younger age of onset. The commonest initial manifestation include musculoskeletal pain. Sicca is rarely the presenting feature, though present in majority. Varied presentations and hence delayed diagnosis. There's low prevalence of Raynaud's, cryoglobulinemia, and hyperglobulinemia in our patients. Seropositivity has good association with major systemic features, and milder forms are usually seronegative. Seropositivity means SSA, SSB, RF, or ANA, and most patients do well with just simple drugs like hydroxychloroquine and methotrexate. So these are some of our publications from Sjogren's syndrome, from our group. And this is the Vellore Fort, which is almost 800 years old. Inside the it was ruled by Cholas, Pallavas. It was a British garrison. It has a church and a mosque and a temple inside the same complex. This is the Vellore Golden Temple. It's a real gold. 2,500 kilogram of gold have been laid over the stone structure. It's one of the nice sites to see this temple. More than God, there is more gold here. And this is the chapel of CMC, College Chapel. This is where the people pray here in the college campus. It's beautiful. And they have light and sound show in the evening with history of Vellore. You know why I'm putting this lady? Somebody can tell, who is she? One of the Williams.
Serena
sisters. Yes.
Serena Williams.
Yeah. And she has got Sjogren's syndrome. That's why I showed you. And this is a beautiful memories from Bangladesh when Atik had invited me years ago. And this was one of the get together group photographs. And this is where Atik took me to Cox Bazar, and beautiful memories with the people. We had a very good time. From there, we had also gone to the island. I forget the name, Saint Martin. I also have a very emotional fact to mention. This is my sister. All of you know her, Sabrina Yasmin. She's a rheumatologist, Atik student. And she took me to my ancestral home. I traced where my grandparents migrated from Bangladesh to then East Pakistan to India. And she traced with the help of her husband. I'm really thankful to her. And we went to our ancestral home. This is a old Burma teak wood. The house, that particular room is, nobody lives there now, just lying dilapidated. But the door is still there. So they showed me the door. And this is on the bank of one of the several ponds in the house. And this is the beautiful green, lush green walking path and all the coconut and